Greetings and welcome to another episode of LGR. A while back, I actually did a video on big box PC games of unusual shapes. And if you didn't happen to catch that one, you can either get the link at the end of the video or in the video description and check that out. But I did skip over one style of big box PC game that's a little bit unusual, at least nowadays for sure. And that is the LP sleeve style box, or record sleeve boxes. And these are friggin' awesome. I've got quite a few of them hanging around up there. So let's just take a look at them in sort of a relaxed manner, a lazy manner, if you will. So in case you're not aware, this is a human hand. It is attached to my forearm. It's very handy. But yeah, LPs, right? So they're records. You might have seen them before if you're a hipster or are slightly awesome. I love the artwork. I love the fact that it's big. I like having a physical media and everything like that. It's just fun, right? Well, I have a very similar affinity towards these LP sleeve style PC game boxes, also known as folios. Where did they originate? Well, the company that made them really popular was Electronic Arts back in the day. When they got started, they were indeed calling themselves Electronic Artists. So it only made sense that they would treat their engineers and designers like rock stars in a way, and that was what these were all about. Was giving them something that sort of mimicked what the music industry did, and not only giving it very cool artwork and packaging to try and sell the product, but also provide a spot here for the developer of the game. Like this one right here has a spot for Michael Cranford of Interplay Productions. And yeah, some extra information about the game. We've got a map here. We have some floppy disks. This is, of course, The Bard's Tale, one of the most classic games from Electronic Arts at that time. Command summary card here, and some information, like a map key right there. But also, you would have, much like a record, the spot would come open, and you would get some more stuff. So we've got the full manual right here, all sorts of information in there, and also The Bard's Tale clue book. I'm not sure if this actually came with it by default, but came with my copy, and my goodness, is it cool. I love this. I love the artwork that's in here. This is super good stuff. And this is why I am such a big fan of both these and records, as well as laser discs and, you know, anything along those lines of like really big physical media. There were many more by Electronic Arts as well, and we're going to go ahead and take a look at quite a few of them, actually. Pretty much everything that I have here. This game is called Worms? With a question mark? I don't know why. This is a game by David S. Maynard. And yeah, it's actually a pretty simple kind of game. It has nothing to do with the Team 17 game, but this one's cool because it opens up and it shows, I'm assuming that's David Maynard there, just sitting in that amazingly cool, comfortable-looking chair with neon worms surrounding him. This right here looks even more like a record sleeve than The Bard's Tale did. I friggin' love this. This is just... I've never even heard of this game before I found this, but, you know, when I saw that it had that kind of sleeve, I had to have it. And here's a game from another company here. This is Micro Illusions. And they released several things in this same sort of LP-style box. This one doesn't actually open up in the middle, but it does have the stuff packed in the side here. Much like a 45 sleeve. This is the Amiga version of this game called Tracers. And it's got this little booklet here. Another one here from Micro Illusions. This is the Fairy Tale Adventure. I have reviewed this before. I don't think that I showed this version of it in my video, but I'm going to do so now. And oh my word, look at this stuff. This is great. You got the author here, David Joyner. Some different people just sort of working on the game and showing some of the things they used as reference to create it. A nice little floppy disk holder right there. That straight up looks like something out of a record of some kind. You know, some butt rock band or something like that. It's great. And I like this game too, even though it's a little crappy nowadays, I think. But still lots of nostalgic stuff for this game. And of course, This is actually packed with a whole bunch of stuff here. We have the map of home. Oh, yes. We have another map here, which is far bigger and far more useful. All of the stuff in the game right there, complete with some grid patterns and everything, which is very useful considering how you play this game. Some stuff for the C64 version, which this is, as well as the Quest and Exploration Guidebook. And this is indeed the manual. These old, like, action RPG sort of adventure-y things would come with so much cool stuff. And they just tried to still pack it into the record sleeve style case. And you can see here, I mean, it's like, it's chock full to the point that it's actually bulging the inside of it outwards. And this is, I don't know, I think a little silly. They put this in a box later on, which that makes sense. It holds everything very nicely, but I guess the EA model of releasing things in this style was just, I mean, it was the cool thing to do for a little while, so everybody wanted to follow suit. And we got quite a few more here from EA, and these are all part of their construction set games. Well, not really games, but they're like game makers. So we have Stuart Smith's Adventure Construction Set, Rick Koenig and Connie Goldman's Racing Destruction Set, Bill Budge's Pinball Construction Set, as well as Will Harvey's Music Construction Set. I love this series of stuff from Electronic Arts back then. These were like some of the most creative things around, really, because they not only let you play some really cool pre-made stuff, but yeah, you could write your own. And, you know, with this one right here, you could make a sort of Ultima-style adventure games and RPGs and whatnot. Ooh, there's a... Ooh, got an ad for Quantum Link in there. Q-Link. That actually became America Online later on. A very detailed amount of instruction stuff for this one. Really, in all of these. It makes sense, though, because, yeah, you're making your own games, effectively. Same thing with Racing Destruction Set here. You could make a top-down racers that are... and side-scrolling ones, I think, as well, that were sort of similar to Iron Man Stewart's Off-Road, as well as things like Rad Race, not Rad Racer, was the other one I'm thinking of. The RC Pro-Am, actually, yeah. Maybe a little bit of Excitebike as well. This is another one that just looks like absolute friggin' rock stars. I mean, look at these. This is great. These people right here, these are the kind of people I want making my games. I don't know about you. I mean, but that right there just screams quality and class. And, of course, the manual. Not as much going on in this one because it's a little simpler than the adventure game one. There's a lot of pre-made stuff in this, but still very cool. Extremely classic pinball construction set. This right here was responsible for so many pinball games and such that were released for free on BBSs and whatnot back in the day. And you found them on a lot of compilations as well because you could actually package these up into like their own executable. And, yeah. But this is another great example of the LP-style sleeve here. All these examples of the things that you can do with it. Some extremely sexy floppy disks and a command summary card there. And then you got Bill Budge with his absolutely psychedelic thing going on. He's like, look at this. You can be me. Creating pinball games straight out of like a, I don't know, prog rock band. This is great. It just goes into detail as well, his, I guess, philosophy as far as making this and what it means to him and everything. This is one of my absolute favorites right here. And finally, Will Harvey's Music Construction Set. Another extremely cool construction set by EA back then. This one was awesome because it worked with a huge variety of sound devices. A lot of stuff that's actually pretty obscure, too. I think even like the IBM Music feature card, but also your PC speaker. And at that point, there weren't many things that you could do to get music out of your PC speaker at all. And with this, well, you certainly could. I would love to show an example of this, but I'm not going to do that in this video. Actually, I'm not showing examples for any of these. We're just looking at the boxes because these are great. I will, however, be covering these in their own video at some point. Yes. Got a nice, pretty substantial reference card right here, as well as the manual itself. Oh, yeah. You need a history of music just to make PC speaker beeps. This is actually extremely competent. I mean, you think something like Mario Paint lets you make music back then. You look at something like this, this is incredible. I love this program, and it was got a great interface and everything as well. Really easy to run, so if you ever run across this, you need to get it. And here's another one that was, it's in the exact same size as those by EA and the other ones that are in the LP sleeve kind of thing, but it's not actually an LP sleeve, but I decided to include it anyway because it's pretty neat and it's kind of a variation on that. This is by Software Country, and I've actually covered this one as well. This is Golden Oldies Volume 1, the only volume that I'm aware of. Comes with some very classic computer and video games, and yes, the whole thing is actually shaped more like a book, so you know, it just folds open and you've got a book. So as opposed to record sleeve kind of stuff. But I mean, you know, it kind of counts as far as I'm concerned, because even though it doesn't have all the cool like artist information that EA would do, it's still really neat and has this cool little slot for your floppy disk to go in. And yeah, here is an arcade classic here by Taito. This is Arkanoid. Suddenly space is a deadly race. Place. Race? Frick. I can't read. That's okay, because we can look at the pretty screenshots on the back here. And yes, this is a great version of Arkanoid, as far as I am concerned. This is the MS-DOS one here. And what's cool about this is it actually opens up into a comic book or sort of a graphic novel deal. Although there's this, just this. It's not like an Infocom one. Some of those had incredibly detailed, like full graphic novels built in. But this one has this right here that shows the predecessor, or, you know, the I guess, prequel to what happens in the game of Arkanoid. I like it. Very colorful. Got a nice looking floppy disk. Just something about the texture of some of these early Taito games. They have a very smooth floppy. I'm just going to leave that statement there. And then, yes, in here, of course, we get a warranty card. What is this? Yeah, this is the Taito fold-out thingy. Shows the other games that they have. Very neat. We got Alcon, Arkanoid, Sky Shark, Bubble Bobble, Operation Wolf, Rastan, Renegade. They had so many cool games. Ugh, they were an excellent company responsible for so many arcade classics and a lot of really respectable conversions, especially for computers like the Apple II GS and the Amiga, but also some very good ones for the IBM PC. They made some really good use of the hardware. Oh, here we have one by the company Mindscape. This is Infiltrator 2 by Chris Gray for the Commodore 64. Yeah, it's not Airwolf. It is Infiltrator. I don't have the first one, but I do have this one here. And, yeah, does this one actually have... No, it doesn't have artist information, which I find kind of curious, because it does actually have, you know, the name of the designer right here, Chris Gray, right on the front, so you would think there would be a little bit more, like, self-pleasuring by the developer inside there, but, you know, whatever, it's just not here, which is interesting. EA was definitely the one, and Activision, of course, at one point, but EA was especially one to really put their developers first in the advertisement and pretty much every step of the way for a long time before they ended up doing different things and became the Electronic Arts that everyone knows and loves nowadays. Now, back to Electronic Arts and... Just a second. Oh, frick. Hello? Yeah, I mean, you know, Duke Nukem and such is... yeah, I mean, you know, if you really think so, you've checked, okay, so config sys is in order. Right. Well, you know, hey, can I call you back, because I'm actually doing an LGR video? Okay, yeah, cool. Yeah, balls of steel, yeah, thanks. Sorry, that was, my DOS emergency phone. It happens on occasion. But anyway, what I was saying, this is another EA game here touchdown football. This is before the John Madden days, and it's actually pretty neat. Let's see here. I don't remember much about this one because I haven't really looked. This actually has a brief history of professional football right there, just in case you weren't familiar with everything that had happened up until like 1986, which is cool. This one doesn't actually make much of a big deal about who designed it. In fact, I don't think it mentions it really anywhere except in the manual itself, which is kind of interesting. This really was about the time that they started caring more about who was sponsoring their games and, you know, who was on the front of the cover, like what celebrity, like John Madden or, you know, Larry Bird or whatever, and instead of who was creating the games, which is kind of a shame. They started going down the sponsorship route, but, well, there you go. That's corporate stuff for you. One more in the classic LP-style box here, and this is Electronic Arts' Starflight by Binary Systems. What a classic game. It has nothing to do with Star Trek, even though it looks like it does by the quote there, but that's just because nobody cared back then. And yeah, this is one that definitely made a kind of a deal about who was involved in creating it, which I'm glad they did, because this looks like something straight out of Alien, and I approve wholeheartedly. Whoever had this before me went all out with like copying down some information for like star charts and stuff, although they're not all here anymore. But look at all these notes, man. Somebody was serious about Starflight. And you know what? I don't blame them, because this is a game that you can just get sucked into for weeks. I need to cover this for sure. Oh, we got a telephone index. I should try to call somebody on my phone over there. Maybe later. We have some warranty information here. The companion card thing. Oh, there's the other half of that. That's good. And the documentation. I mean, that's not even the documentation. That's just all that stuff. Right here. That's the manual. Pretty beefy. Lots of stuff to keep track of. This is really an impressive game. Very cool game. And here we have a poster. Check this out. I love this. See if I can get it all in there. Yeah, this is the Star Flight Star Map. And you know, this is the kind of stuff that you're just not going to get on GOG. And even if you do, it's just going to be scans and you can't have it just out here. I mean, you can just get this, put it on your wall right next to your IBM and be like, yeah, I am getting so into Star Flight. It is absolutely absurd. Do not bother me for the next 3 months. And of course, we have here some floppy disks that I find to be wonderful. Oh, and here, oh yes. This is a copy protection code wheel. Oh, aren't these a blast? Not really. But now they're fun novelties, I gotta say. Wow, you can tell where somebody held that one. Well, I'm gonna hold it right here while I do the code every single time. Jeez. And this does indeed fold out to show some spaciness right here. This looks almost like a, I don't know, like one of those spray paint paintings you would get like from a street vendor in the middle of a big city. I love this stuff. It's so cool. And last but not least, let me just kind of show an interim from the boxes that they did in the LP style, and the later boxes from Electronic Arts, let's say, not even too much later here, like John Madden Football, for instance. Now, this came out in 1988 and then 1989, and yeah, every freaking year since then. But yeah, even though they have a very similar thickness here, they went to this more kind of standardized form factor of boxes by that point. But yeah, we're not here to look at Madden right now. We're here to look at The Bard's Tale 2, The Destiny Knight. And you can see why they went for this thicker style box here, because while they wanted to kind of make it in line with their LP style boxes, it also just had so much stuff that it came with that it made very little sense to just overstuff the package like was happening with Fairy Tale Adventures. So yeah, lots and lots of stuff in this one. I got manuals all over the place. This is, I guess there's two. I don't know why. Do I have two manuals? No. Okay, well, whatever. I've got a couple of those. And then, oh, look at all this. We got maps, and somebody made a crap load of notes. I'm assuming this didn't actually come with it, but either way, isn't this great? I love when I find notes in here. not everything has two sides. Oh man, that's deep. I will be sure to remember that. Bard's Tale, what a wonderful series of games. Pretty much everything in here I need to cover. That's kind of sad. Well, anyway, that's going to be all for this video right now. I hope you have enjoyed this. And if you did, then perhaps you'd like to check out my other one that I made on unusually shaped PC game boxes. Much more unusual than these record sleeve things. You can check that out here, as well as my other recent videos. And you can also subscribe if you'd like to be notified whenever there are more. Every Monday and Friday here in LGR, as well as stuff that happens on Twitter and Facebook and supporting the show on Patreon. That's all linkable right here if you got annotations on, or you can just check the description. As always, thank you very much for watching.